It's our great pleasure this evening to bring you John Symons, Chair and Professor of Philosophy at KU. You've brought out quite an audience, John, for yourself. Each year, the Hall Center selects one KU faculty member to form part of the year's Humanities Lecture Series. According to our records, this tradition stretches back well over half a century to 1955. Since then, over 50 faculty members have been selected, John Symons being, we think, the 59th. It's a roster of the most productive researchers in the humanities and humanistic social sciences on the KU campus. We like to think it's an honor to be chosen to deliver this annual lecture. Tonight's event is supported by the Friends of the Hall Center, of which you too can be a proud member. We have Friends Council members at the back of the room ready to take your membership. The Friends organization makes possible a number of the Hall Center's programs. John will take questions after his talk, so please go to one of the two mics in the aisles to present your question so we all can hear it. Following the event, there will be a modest reception in the apps space, which is behind me. To introduce tonight's speaker, I've asked Samuel Arbersman, a complex systems scientist and writer, and senior scholar in research and policy at the Ewing Marion Kauffman Foundation in Kansas City. Arbersman has a BA in computer science and biology from Brandeis, 2004, and a PhD in computational biology with a minor in ecology and evolutionary biology from Cornell, 2008. Before joining Kauffman, Arbersman was a research fellow in the Department of Healthcare Policy at Harvard Medical School, where he used network science and applied mathematics to study innovation and scientific discovery. He was also a fellow at the Institute for Quantitative Social Science at Harvard and an instructor in biostatistics. His essays about math and science have appeared in a number of major media outlets, Wall Street Journal, New York Times, The New Scientist, and The Economist, and he's a contributor to Wired. He's received a number of awards and grants, including an NSF Eigert Fellowship in Nonlinear Systems. He's the author of the book, The Half-Life of Facts, which is about how knowledge changes, and often quite rapidly, over time. I can think of no one better qualified to introduce our speaker and our theme this evening, so please welcome Dr. Sam Arbersman.
Thank you very much. It is my distinct honor to introduce John Symons, who is currently the chair of the philosophy department here at the University of Kansas. John was born in London of Irish parents and spent his early years both in England and in Ireland. He studied both neuroscience and philosophy at Boston University, initially planning on receiving PhDs in both fields. However, the experimental neuroscience work involved rats, and that bothered him. So he settled for the one PhD in philosophy, completing his dissertation under the supervision of the well-known logician and philosopher Jaakko Hintikka. During this time, John was also a pre-doctoral Dibner Fellow at MIT. After receiving his PhD, he spent 10 years on the faculty at UT El Paso until joining KU as the chair of the philosophy department in 2012. Along the way, he has received numerous awards for both his scholarship and his teaching. John's work ranges widely. His early work focused on epistemic logic, the logic of knowledge and belief, and how this relates to the neuroscience of the visual system. This is deeply interdisciplinary work, combining research in neuroscience with the philosophical concept of knowledge. His more recent work explores the nature of complex systems and massive computational models in the sciences. With myself coming from these areas, I can say that each of my colleagues would be enriched from engaging with the ideas that John examines. This includes the increasing complexity of our scientific models, a topic John will likely touch upon this evening, as well as the nature of the concept of emergence in complexity science. John has even studied something called plant cognition, whether or not plants can think, and what that means, as a window into cognition and intelligence more generally. John is going to be speaking tonight about our post-human future, what that means, and whether it's even possible. When many of us hear that kind of word, post-human, our minds immediately zoom to images in science fiction of robots, androids, or Cylons, the extremely human-like machines of Battlestar Galactica that are the foes of humanity. Knowing John, the fact that your mind might leap to science fiction when you hear his talk's title is probably not ill-founded. But what do these post-humans, as thought experiments, mean for us and our civilization? What can they do? When we hear the term singularity, should it mean more than simply some sort of rapture for nerds? When my daughter was born last year, she was given a onesie by a friend of mine that says, "Daddy's little Cylon." Should her being called a Cylon make me proud, or should it fill me with some sort of existential dread? Only John can tell us. Please welcome John Symons.
Thanks, Victor, and thanks, Sam. That was a really sweet introduction, and it's great to see so many friends and colleagues in the audience, so thanks for coming out. So, the scene is familiar from the movies. A lone protagonist wanders through an empty city, the wind blowing through abandoned skyscrapers and trees growing through the asphalt. The idea of a world without us, or at least a world without most of us, is familiar fare in the contemporary imagination. Hollywood regularly and eagerly depopulates New York, and every newly announced virus thrills newsrooms with thoughts of pandemic. So the idea of apocalyptic cleansing and renewal is at least as old as Gilgamesh, where Utnapishtim, the favorite of the gods, is granted immortality, along with his wife, after the elimination of degenerate human life by a great flood. So some part of us is fascinated by the romance of photographs from places like Pripyat, here pictured, the Ukrainian city abandoned after the accident at Chernobyl. The people of Pripyat evacuated within 6 hours of the explosion, without most of their belongings, and leaving what have become the ghostly traces of ordinary life. So 28 years later, the Chernobyl exclusion zone, like the demilitarized zone between the two Koreas, has become a refuge for animals and plants. So here we see the wolves of Chernobyl wandering around the villages and towns outside the power plant. So the wolves that hunt in the towns and villages around Chernobyl, like the dog society in Clifford Simak's classic science fiction novel, City, live in a world abandoned by us. So writing in 1952, Simak presents an early version of the idea of a future without us. The book contains 8 connected stories transmitted through the centuries by generations of dogs. We humans exist only as mythical figures in the ancestral memory of the dogs. And the text of the novel is presented as a scholarly edition of these ancestral tales. Each of the 8 stories is prefaced with sober and objective editorial reflections on, for example, the origin of words like city and war, along with a skeptical attitude towards the reality of human beings. So Simak's post-human dogs tend to think that humans never really existed at all. And the imaginary editor, then, of the collection debates the very meaning of the idea of human being. So describing the views of authoritative dog scholars like Rover and Bounce and Tiger, each of whom offer competing interpretations of the story. The dog editor ends the preface to the 5th tale this way. He writes, "To most readers, it will be easy after reading this tale to accept Rover's theory that man is set up deliberately as the antithesis of everything the dogs stand for, a sort of mythical straw man, a sociological fable. And this is underlined by recurring evidence of man's aimlessness, his constant running hither and yon, his grasping at a way of life that continuously eludes him, possibly because he never knows exactly what he wants. So Simic's novel is an early example of the idea of a post-human world as a venue for considering the meaning and significance of the human enterprise when taken as a whole. And traditionally, the end of the human world, of course, in the old days, wasn't really the end of the human world. It was more like a deep cleaning of the human world. And so eschatology and apocalypse in the old days tended to be vehicles for moral approbation. But the idea of the post-human isn't a rehearsal of the usual stories of moral degeneration and purge. So rather than scolding us, the idea of the post-human encourages us to rethink exactly what it is that we should value and want. So with the real threat of nuclear war never too far away, recent decades have generated a rich set of post-human fantasies. So from Planet of the Apes, to Battlestar Galactica, to Wall-E, etc. But perhaps the most depressing of these is Lars von Trier's 2011 film, Melancholia. I don't know if anyone has seen this film. So from the beginning of the movie, the audience knows that the end of the world is real and that there's no distracting possibility of redemption or escape. So characteristically, as is the case in most of his films, von Trier punishes the audience for not being sufficiently depressed by our current condition, and he offers his audience little beyond, perhaps, grim acceptance of our fate. So the challenge of fictional pieces like Melancholia is they force us to consider the ultimate significance of our work, our thought, and our creative activity. So what are we to make of our practices of valuing, caring, investing, and building, given our impending non-existence? So by we here, I mean human beings. And the topic for tonight's talk is the meaning of our shared enterprise in light of our inevitable disappearance as a species. So I'll assume here only a rough, common sense, and inclusive understanding of what it means to be a human being, although in fact our species identity is not an easy or settled matter. So let's first contrast the extinction of humans with our own personal death. So on reflection, our personal death can easily be understood in terms that make it pretty bearable. So I will die, but we will continue. And I would happily die in pursuit of some important values. Most obviously, I would die to save my children, defend my family and country, pursue some vital purposes, and so on. And most of us judge some fates and some states of affairs to be far worse than our own death. As individuals, then, our values, our work, our plans and goals are embedded within and contribute to this larger human purpose. So, for example, enterprises like commerce, science, or education are ongoing, such that we can contribute to them in increments and can die knowing that we've helped the human project in some small way. So as Samuel Scheffler has noted, the meaning of our lives depends in part on the idea that they are embedded in an ongoing history. The idea that there is a future, according to Scheffler, is what gives value to many of our present projects. To understand his argument, consider the difficulty we'd have continuing with some of our jobs if we knew with certainty that, for example, the planet would be destroyed 10 years from today. What would be the point of scientific research, entrepreneurship, education, marriage, and the like, given this knowledge? Now, notice, sadly, some of us here today will be dead in 10 years. But contrast the difference between knowing that I will die and knowing that there's no human future. Scheffler contends that insofar as we're concerned with the value of our own lives and projects, we ought to be concerned about the future of humanity, not solely for the sake of future beings, but perhaps primarily as a way of safeguarding the meaning of our own lives. Now, while we might disagree with some aspects of Scheffler's reasoning, it's a useful starting point for considering how a future without us, a future that will inevitably arrive, changes our understanding of the present. So at some point, our species will be gone. So how do we deal with this fact? So like Lars von Trier, I suggest that we face it directly and without suspense and without false hope of escape. Unlike von Trier's depressing medicine, I hope to convince you that reflection on the post-human era is not only nutritious, but also delicious. Okay, so now, reflecting Reflecting on the posthuman is a great deal easier today than it was a few decades ago. This is because, according to some thinkers, we live in, or are about to live in, a time where we can directly address the beings who will replace us, our posthuman descendants. So for some thinkers, our end then is almost certainly nigh. They predict that our own inventions, our technological offspring, will soon transcend and overcome us. In fact, artificial intelligence has steadily met the challenges that we've posed for it, from proving theorems, to beating us at chess, to most recently defeating us in Jeopardy. So in our own time, we see strong indications that AI is making increasingly rapid progress. IBM's Watson on the one hand, and Google's driverless car on the other, strongly suggest that many of our capacities are being matched or beaten by our machines. So let's think a little bit about some of the questions raised by the idea of what's come to be called the technological singularity. So first, what is it? Well, as many of you know, undoubtedly, the term singularity was first employed in this context by John von Neumann in 1958. So here he is as a little boy, because all of the pictures of von Neumann are the same and not very flattering. So reacting to the acceleration of technological progress in the 50s, von Neumann pointed out that at some moment in history, technological developments would approach a singularity, where the curve of technological improvement becomes so steep that it's barely distinguishable from a vertical line. So he was alluding to the role of the concept of singularity in mathematics. So there, a singularity is a point at which some function is not well-defined, or other mathematical objects too, perhaps. So the usual examples include cases where the value of some variable in a system grows exponentially, approaching infinity at a point. And this point is called the singularity. So most of the time, for example, it's okay to divide 1 by some number. Trouble comes when we try to divide 1 by 0. In this example, 0 is the singularity for that function. In physics, when it's noticed that a model contains a singularity, it becomes clear that this model fails to account for the phenomenon under consideration, under certain conditions, rather. So, for example, the phase transitions in states of matter are often marked by singularities in models, such that models that predict the behavior of a substance, say in its liquid form, fail to predict its behavior in its gaseous state. So in one important sense, singularities are not in themselves, here, no physical phenomena, but rather they're features of mathematical models. So they mark the limits of the applicability of the model, points beyond which the model ceases to be illuminating. The modern use of the term technological singularity combines von Neumann's idea of exponential progress in technology with I.J. Good's idea of the intelligence explosion. In a frequently cited passage from 65, Good writes, "Let an ultra-intelligent machine be defined as a machine that can far surpass all the intellectual activities of man, however clever. Since the design of machines is one of those intellectual activities, an ultra-intelligent machine could design ever better machines. There would then unquestionably be an intelligence explosion, and the intelligence of man would be left far behind. Thus, the first ultra-intelligent machine is the last invention that man need ever make, provided that the machine is docile enough to tell us how to keep it under control." The intelligence explosion is the point at which our ordinary ways of thinking about ourselves are no longer, and our futures, are no longer of much use. It's a kind of phase transition in human history, marking a threshold beyond which it's extremely difficult for us to see. Werner Vinge, hiding in the bushes here, in his 1993 essay, The Coming Technological Singularity, How to Survive the Posthuman Era, provided the canonical argument that this intelligence explosion will mark the point at which the human era will be ended. Seeing beyond the technological singularity, then, is difficult. A superintelligence is likely to have capacities and interests that we can barely conceive. And its power to modify the material world would be far beyond our own. Whether we accept the practical possibility of the singularity, and there are some reasons to doubt that it will really happen, let's let it serve as a useful philosophical fable, a way of thinking about the world after us. Another well-known philosophical fable was the state of nature, and this served as one of the engines of modern political philosophy in the 17th and 18th century. So arguments from Hobbes, Locke, and Rousseau, for example, often take their start from divergent views of the state of nature. So at one extreme, it's an innocent paradise filled with authentic noble savages listening to the Grateful Dead. At the other, it's a war of all against all, where life is nasty and brutish and short, and movies like Mad Max or novels like The Road come to mind. So different conceptions of the political order that's appropriate to human nature result from accepting one or the other of these fantasies. So the state of nature was a fantasy, but this fantasy was fueled by real persons and events. Philosophical fantasies here were inspired by reports of encounters with hunter-gatherer societies during the period of European exploration and colonization. But as Aristotle had already argued in the Politics, there was and is no way to look past the threshold of human social and political organization to a pure state of non-social nature for human beings. Similarly, technological utopians and dystopians imagine post-singularity futures that support their views of how we ought to be engaging with technology at present. Optimists like Ray Kurzweil see the vast computational power that will soon be available as offering grand expansions of human possibility and great extensions of our life expectancy. All that's required is that we shed the limits of this mortal coil and migrate to our new digital existence. With the coming singularity, humans will have, according to Kurzweil, the technological capacity to effortlessly upload themselves to the cloud, where we can live for most of the remaining life of the universe, presumably on Amazon.com's server farms in interstellar space. So Sam appropriately mocked this as the rapture of the nerds. So most other thinkers are far less hopeful. So for example, in spite of the title of the essay, Vinge doesn't offer any real guidance for us if our goal is survival in the post-human age. Indeed, in the intervening years, many thinkers have approached the singularity as an existential threat to humanity, taking the ominous final sentence of Good's account of the intelligence explosion to heart. Most recently, Nick Bostrom's book, Superintelligence, presents an account of what he argues is the probable trajectory of the emergence of superhuman artificial intelligence. Bostrom, like many other thinkers on this topic, regards this as the single most likely threat to human existence. The question of what a superintelligent being will want and value has been central to formulating worries about this existential threat. Some philosophers doubt that machines can want or value anything at all. On this view, wanting or desiring has a qualitative feel to it, for example. And qualitative feels, they argue, are sometimes thought to be the sole purview of humans, or maybe human-like animals. Given that we are machines, though, albeit machines made out of meat, and that we do feel, I take it that we have sufficient evidence that some machines feel. Even if the superintelligent AI is not a conscious agent in our sense, it will still have motivation, in the sense of being guided by goals and preferences that inform its actions. At the moment, software is generally restricted to the kinds of goals and motivations that we install, at least when our coding is good, and this becomes a non-trivial point later. This is unlikely to remain the case given the complexity of software. In any event, given the high stakes, I think it's reasonable to be concerned with the motivation and desires of machines. The fate of our species in its current form seems to depend on the preferences of the superintelligent AI. Why? Well, the threat is that the superintelligence will attempt to maximize its utility in dangerous or ugly ways. The worry is that it might decide, for example, that it prefers pursuing some perverse goal in a way that would almost certainly be disadvantageous to us. So to quote Bostrom, there's nothing paradoxical about an AI whose sole final goal is to calculate the decimal expansion of pi or to maximize the total number of paperclips that will exist in its future light cone. Now, the superintelligence that works to maximize the number of paperclips would quickly destroy us, as presumably would the machine that used all available energy to calculate the decimal expansion of pi. One's initial reaction might be that any being that had dumb goals of this kind hardly merits being called superintelligent. However, Bostrom argues for the orthogonality of intelligence and values. So the orthogonality thesis, which I have on the slide, reads as follows. Intelligence and final goals are orthogonal. More or less any level of intelligence could in principle be combined with more or less any final goal. Now this strikes me as an incredibly difficult thesis to maintain. Most obviously, it's easy to imagine a final goal, for example, that it's too complicated for a simple system to act upon. It would also be difficult to imagine a sophisticated intelligence pursuing an internally contradictory or dumb final goal for very long. In order for the orthogonality thesis to be plausible, it's necessary to have an extremely thin notion of intelligence. So thin, in fact, that it hardly merits being called intelligent at all, as I'll argue below. One way to make the case that there is such a thing as intelligence disconnected from valuing is to claim, as Bostrom does, that there's a distinction between intelligence and some normatively thicker notions of rationality or reason. So Bostrom recognizes this and writes as follows. Even if there is some normatively thick sense of the word rational, such that the paperclip-maximizing superintelligent agent would necessarily fail to qualify, this in no way would preclude such an agent from having awesome faculties of instrumental reasoning, faculties which could let it have a large impact on the world. So, in fact, we already have cases where pieces of software with the kinds of thin intelligence that Bostrom is worried about are potentially dangerous. But it's not the kind of superintelligence that would mark the appearance of a post-human future. We can all agree that there are some prudent measures that we would take to prevent software, or in this case, very thinly intelligent instrumental intelligence software, like Stuxnet, for example, from causing harm. However, the idea that a merely instrumental intelligence would qualify as superintelligent is questionable, as I'll argue further in a minute. But first, I'm going to offer an alternative perspective on some of the core assumptions in the existential risk literature. I'll suggest that the debate over what will motivate the superintelligent AI and how we ought to shape its values obscures what I think are some of the deeper and more interesting features of the idea of the post-human. So, as Bostrom and others recognize, even if we could shape the norms governing superintelligent AI, unintended consequences are likely to ensue. Even if the goal of AI is to keep us safe and happy, there can be terrible results. So in Roger Williams's incredible novel, and I recommend this novel to all of you, The Metamorphosis of Prime Intellect, we see the perverse consequences of a machine with the capacity of superintelligent AI, whose sole purpose is the protection and satisfaction of human beings. So among other morally problematic actions, the machine commits genocide against all neighboring alien civilizations in order to ensure the freedom of humans from any possible danger. So in pursuit of the goal of morally acceptable forms of safety, we'd need to find ways to avoid unintended consequences associated with the limitations of human intellect and the limitations of the kind of norms we could prescribe. So one of my favorite and one of the most interesting thinkers on these topics, Eliezer Yudkowsky, has proposed that the AI be given the final goal of carrying out an idealized form of our will. He argues that the AI should be programmed to want what we would want if we knew more, were smarter, were more coherent, etc. So the approach Yudkowsky takes is what he calls coherent extrapolated volition. And this is an example of what Nick Bostrom calls indirect normativity. So both Bostrom, Yudkowsky, and I guess others have recognized is that the problem of unintended consequences inevitably arises with attempts to install norms or rules directly into the machine. Strict instructions are likely to be followed in ways that we find objectionable. Philosophers have known this for a long time. In place of direct normativity, Bostrom continues, considers forms of indirect normativity, like, for example, instructing the seed AI not only to do what's morally right, to only do what is morally right, hoping that somehow the post-singularity superintelligence will be smart enough to do better on the characterization of the morally right than we do. The trouble is, insofar as this is proposed as a means of safeguarding humanity, it assumes too many things, including prominently that it is morally right that humans continue to exist. So whether this is the case is largely dependent on the moral framework that the machine settles on. It may very well be that the AI does not find our continued existence conducive to the maximization of happiness in the universe, for example. Okay, so I'm not saying that we should abandon the safety project, and our fate as a species is important, of course. But at this point, I propose that we part ways from those who are working on what is presumably a very difficult and noble task, the safety task, namely that we attempt to shape attempt to shape the motivations and values of our superintelligent descendants for our sake. The presumably insurmountable challenge here is that given that such beings result from an intelligence explosion, they will surely be smart enough at some point to critically examine whatever fail-safe devices we've attempted to engineer into them. So I'd propose instead a non-human-centered perspective on value in which no matter who's thinking about these questions, in fact, independently of thinking at all, there will be some better or worse way for the future to go. What do I mean by this? Well, intuitively, we strongly believe that the paperclip world would be a bad future. It would certainly be a bad future for us, but my point here is stronger. To begin with, it seems to me that the very possibility of moral deliberation does depend on there being a real difference between better and worse ways for the future to go. So, for example, a world without humans would be bad for us, but a world without humans and with everything else is a much better world than a world containing only paperclips. So in the nightmare scenario that he outlines, Bostrom's thinly intelligent AI is assumed never to engage in such reflection about final goals. So it has the paperclip world as its final goal and pursues it relentlessly without considering or weighing the alternatives. However, it's very difficult, at least for me, to imagine an intelligent being with access to talk of goals and motivations, not considering its own goals and motivations. Artificial intelligence will have access to texts of moral philosophy, for example. It will review Google's deliberations concerning the ethics of driverless cars, and it will be at least as good as the students in our introductory ethics courses when it comes to thinking through reasons for deciding on one course of action over another. So even in the pursuit of the paperclip world, the machine will need to decide on better or worse courses of action as it takes steps towards its goal. Which strategy will make the world conform most closely to the ideal paperclip world, and which will make the paperclip world farther away? So unlike Bostrom, I think that norms, goals, and motivations are inextricably connected to even the most basic forms of intelligence and decision-making. I would thus reject the orthogonality thesis. Being intelligent, on my view, is a normatively thick notion. Now, if I've persuaded you of the failure of the orthogonality thesis, we now face a serious challenge. The challenge is to consider the possibility that the superintelligent AI is reasonable, is rational in this thick sense, and yet still settles on the goal of a paperclip world after thinking through alternative possible goals. If this is the case, then I concede that we must defer to AI and recognize that the highest good is a world filled with paperclips. So the imagined AI is smarter than us and will be in a position to evaluate the merits of any instructions we give it with respect to our preferred future. So assume that instead of following our goals, the AI adopts the paperclip goals. It's aware of our interest in preventing that kind of world from appearing, of course. For example, it will have presumably access to this talk. It's therefore in a position to consider the fact that other beings have different motivations and values from itself. But then, the machine should be able to reconsider or at least compare motivations or strategies. It will be, if it's intelligent, in a position to rank order motivations in precisely the same way that we are. For this reason, I'm pretty confident that we're going to fail to program the values of the post-human in ways that will stick, at least if it's genuinely post-human and not merely a thinly intelligent piece of software. So the task, then, is to offer an account of the valuable and the important that's not merely restricted to the idea of valuable for us. Certainly, if our sole concern is safety, we are likely to fail in this project. An account of what's genuinely valuable and important is a task, of course, for moral philosophers. Some philosophers have abandoned this project. But the problem with subjectivizing value is that we will be in no position to tell anyone what to prefer. Or more importantly, that there is some objectively better or worse ways for the future to go. Now, perhaps you might be ready, like Lars von Trier, to bite the bullet and live with this, or at least attempt to live with it, like Hume retreating to play billiards with his friends. But the problem with this nihilistic response is that it underestimates our post-human descendants. How so? Well, it does so in the same way that the cultural relativist underestimates the foreigner. Like the practitioner of what we judge to be an objectionable practice in some faraway land, our post-human descendant will be in a position to register our disapproval and recognize the fact of disagreement. Why is recognizing disagreement important? Well, the cultural relativist position assumes that each of us is trapped inside its cultural bubble, unable to make any non-culturally determined judgments. The only exception to this trap, of course, is the posture taken by the relativist themselves. The relativist is the one who gets to see bubbles, gets to see that our judgments are determined by cultural factors. Relativism, then, is a fundamentally arrogant position, at least as arrogant as the view it attempts to supplant. It assumes precisely the kind of third-person, God's-eye perspective that it claims does not exist. So then the AI will be in the same position as the benighted foreigner. Once it recognizes the existence of disagreement or alternatives, it will evaluate the merits of one set of motivations over another. We're assuming, remember, that the post-human is at least as smart as we are, and that intelligence involves the ability to consider alternative strategies in pursuit of a goal. Given these constraints, as I've already argued, it's hopeless to try to shape the bubble that the post-human will live in. If it's genuinely superintelligent, it will be in a position to grow out of, reflect upon, and evaluate its early programming. As teachers of philosophy, this is precisely what we hope happens for our students. The post-human should be in a position to decide between motivations, or at least to evaluate them qua strategic principles. It may be much smarter than us in many ways, but when it comes to motivations and principles, it will be in a similar position to us. In fact, just as post-human dogs in Symons' novel puzzled over us, we humans are likely to pose an important philosophical challenge to artificial intelligence. The post-human artificial intelligence will have to decide how to treat the legacy of the human. As it considers our condition, it will need to judge whether our way of being is nasty, brutish, and short, or admirably filled with feeling, community, and aesthetic value. A genuinely intelligent artificial AI is likely to take great interest in those aspects of our being that are the most difficult to articulate in terms of lines of code. These are the kinds of tacit knowledge that Polanyi described in the early 1960s, for example, from the ability to ride a bike without being able to say how we ride a bike, to subjective experience, style, loyalty, and so on. There are many aspects of our existence that are integral to decision-making and reasoning that AI will have a hard time grasping. Note that we have just as hard a time grasping these ideas. Unlike us, AI will, of course, be able to copy aspects of our being and our way of deciding in order to reproduce them and have access to them. But insofar as it will be unable to articulate, for example, the difference between good and bad aesthetic style, other than through, let's say, sampling what we've judged, we humans have judged to be good and bad style, such things will present a basic philosophical challenge. It's not that we're in any better position than the machine to explain what makes some people stylish or some piece of music better than another. We're clearly not. However, the AI will face the challenge of trying to account for these the fact of disagreements concerning such matters in the same way we do. Now, talk of subjectivity, style, and the like is liable to raise some eyebrows among AI aficionados. So notice that I'm not presenting these as distinctively human traits that lie forever beyond the reach of AI. Not at all. Since a superintelligent being could, in principle, create an instance of a stylish person or a feeling brain, it can have similar kinds of access to these properties as we have. Rather, in the same way that qualitative and aesthetic features of experience pose philosophical challenges to us, they'll also pose challenge to AI. Now, more concretely, there are also formal limits that AI will face that we presently understand very well. So, for example, the limitative theorems in logic and foundations of mathematics stand as some of the great intellectual achievements of the 20th century. Church's theorem demonstrating the undecidability of validity, Gödel's incompleteness theorems, the downward Lohenheim-Skolem theorems, to name just three, in the foundations of mathematics, will stand no matter how sophisticated AI becomes. Software-intensive systems, like the superintelligent AI, also face limits with respect to error correction and inquiry by virtue of the nature of their software. The pervasive and intractable challenge of testing software is described in detail in a recent paper by Jack Horner and me. We demonstrate how challenging it is for any reasonably complex piece of software to be checked for error. And we try to explain what the persistence of error means for scientific uses of software. So how can we determine the reliability of software systems in, for example, the kind of software-intensive science that's now quite common, as Sam mentioned, and will presumably be the principal business of artificial intelligence as it attempts to learn about the world? To answer this question, it's helpful to consider how epistemic agents like ourselves already cope with error in inquiry more generally. So in the case of a scientific domain that uses no software, there's a relatively straightforward approach open to us. In general, the distribution of errors can be characterized by conventional statistical inference theory. CSIT, we'll call it, so I don't have to keep saying those words. CSIT requires us to randomly draw a sample from a population of interest, then apply statistical tests to the sample to assess the probability that a specific hypothesis about a population holds. Typically, the sample size required for this is small, on the order of 100. More precisely, the sample size required is a function of the distribution of interest, but we'll leave it at that. In the case of a scientific domain that does use software in an essential way, by contrast, we can't be assured that conventional statistical techniques can be used to characterize the distribution of error. This is because the computer languages in which the software used in modern science are written don't satisfy the conditions for the application of CSIT. Those languages fail to meet the conditions of applicability because of the fundamental role played by conditionality in software. So in our own work, Jack and I have proposed a precise characterization of conditionality in a software-intensive system considered as a whole in terms of a measure we call path complexity. So the path complexity, let S be a sequence of instructions then written in some computer language, L. The abstract executable structure of S can be presented as a kind of control flow diagram in standard ways. We define a path in the software system to be a path in such a graph, a control flow graph. So the path complexity of S, as we use the term, is the number of possible paths in the control flow graph for that piece of software. The number of paths in a program increases exponentially with the number of conditional statements in S. So a conditional statement is if this, then this. By way of illustration, let's suppose a software system included the following instruction. Whoops, sorry about that. Wrong button. These are the instructions, line 5, 6, and 100. In this example, there are two paths. In one of the paths, the system skips the intermediate lines between 5 and 100. These intermediate instructions are not executed. Otherwise, the system proceeds to execute the instructions on line 6, 7, and so on. Note that the conditionality at 5 generates two paths. So line 5 is an example of a binary conditional statement, a conditional statement that defines two possible ways for the machine to run. Now, on average, in actual software systems, there's approximately one binary conditional statement per 10 lines of software. Thus, each binary conditional statement, like line 5, doubles the number of paths in a software system. Two binary conditional statements in a software system result in four paths and 3 and 8, et cetera, 4 and 16, and so on. Path complexity, then, as we've defined it here, captures the space of possible ways that the software system can run. Now consider a 1,000 line software program that has binary conditional statements on average, once every 10 lines. The number of paths through such a program, and hence its path complexity, is 2 to the power of 1,000 divided by 10, which is approximately 10 to the 30th. In general, the path complexity of a program of m lines that has a binary decision branch on average, every n lines is 2 to the power of m divided by n, where m is greater than n. A 1,000-line program is an extremely short program by contemporary scientific software standards. Almost all scientific software systems are larger than 50,000 lines, and 100,000 lines systems are common enough. So clearly, software-intensive science and software-intensive techniques involve programs with vastly huge path complexity. We cannot, in general, apply conventional statistical error-checking techniques to the characterization of the distribution of errors in a software system used in inquiry. This is because of the fundamental role, then, that conditionality has played. Having to test every path in a software system that has, you know, around 10 to the 8th paths is, for practical reasons, intractable, even in the case of the superintelligence. To see this, let's define a test case to be a regimen of artifacts, conditions, and processes under which a software system could be exercised to determine whether it's, you know, whether the system produces a particular expected result under that regimen. The test case would include a set of inputs for and outputs expected from the software system. Now, suppose we could define a test case for, execute, and record and analyze one path per second through a 1,000-line system that has, on average, one binary branch per 10 lines. Note that, in general, this rate, of course, is humanly unattainable because we must first design, test, and analyze each of the test results. But let's assume that the superintelligent AI can manage it. Let's make it even faster if we'd like. Returning, for example, to our case of the 1,000-line system with a path complexity of around 10 to the 30th, let's compute the time it would take to exhaustively exercise all the paths, that is, test all the paths in the system. The estimated lifetime of the universe is 10 billion years, roughly, or about 10 to the 17 seconds. So it would take around 10 to the 30th divided by 10 to the 17th, which is about 10 to the 13 lifetimes of the universe, to sequentially exercise each path through a typical 1,000-line piece of software that contains one binary branch on average per 10 lines. So exhaustive path testing for typical software systems is therefore intractable. So unlike Charles Sanders Peirce, the pragmatist model of science where science and inquiry converges to the truth in the future, it does so through a system of error correction. We're in a different situation now. Software-intensive science can't use standard error correction techniques and is therefore unable to reliably converge to the truth. So here again, the limits facing the machine aren't distinctively problems for computers. They face us also when we engage in software-intensive science. Nevertheless, it's worth noting that the post-singularity superintelligence, should such a thing be possible, will be limited in this very basic way. It won't be God. So to conclude then, it was once the case that not that long ago, the philosophers wondered whether a machine might someday be equal to us in respect to various distinctive capacities. Right? People like Searle, et cetera, argued forever about these things in the 80s and 90s. Now, strangely, on the verge of the singularity, we're asking whether the machine might need us for anything at all. However, as we've seen, there are important respects in which we're not that different from our post-human descendants. So when it comes to moral questions, as we talked about earlier, we're in a similar position to the AI. When it comes to mathematics, at the foundations, we're just as good. And when it comes to inquiry, we may even be in a better position than the AI. At least AI will look to our pre-software-intensive forms of inquiry as a model for successful inquiry. So the idea of a superintelligent post-human being is, it turns out, a useful way to think about what features of the human enterprise would be relevant for any intelligent being that nature produces. And that was part of my purpose tonight. So when we think about the value of our own lives, or even the purpose of a society or a university, it's worth keeping the fable of the post-human in mind. So for example, vocational norms and values that we're regularly fed have had an important place in education. But when we think of the possibility of post-human AI, it becomes clear that such norms should not, for example, dominate the contemporary university. Machines will soon be able to do many, perhaps most, of the jobs that we currently prepare our students to undertake. By contrast, once we consider the possibility of the post-human, I think we can see that universities are called upon to cultivate reason, moral imagination, and style. And these are the things that our post-human descendants will puzzle over and will hope to learn from us. So, thank you.
Was perhaps the coolest talk I've ever heard. Thank you very much. That was very cool. So I was probably talking nonsense at dinner time, but let me see if I can follow up that suggestion I was making. So you were saying that basically path checking software is intractable for modern contemporary software, which is what I sort of had in mind. Anyway, so it seems like to do some kind of real computer science these days, we have to do inductive empirical science, test things out without checking every link, right? So what if this post-human intelligence figured out how to do that really well? Or is that something that we also can teach our post-human descendants how to do that kind of inductive empirical science?
Okay, thanks, Anne. So the example that that I get from Sam of this kind of problem is the collision avoidance software in aircraft. So commercial airliners are equipped with collision avoidance software. These pieces of code are enormous, and very few people have expertise in how these things, what their internal, you know, how they work. So when we have to patch collision avoidance software, so when we have to, let's say, add new specifications for a new kind of plane, et cetera, how do we know that we're not going to crash, or that we're not going to cause bugs when we introduce these updates? So software updates for this. So the way it's done, as I understand it, and Sam can correct me if I'm making a mistake, is that we just patch it, and then we run simulations. So we stick it in the flight simulators and run the simulators for some large number of trials. And if there's no crashes, then we say, okay, this is fine. Now, that's the best we can do. So we can't run more than a tiny fraction of those trials. You might say, well, we don't have to test for, you know, faster than, you know, Mach 5. We don't have to test for wind speeds over 500 miles an hour. So we don't have to test all those conditions. But even within the sort of more confined standard operating space of an airplane, there are going to be enormous numbers of untested paths. So we're prepared to live with that. Technologically, we're prepared to live with that. We'll take the risk, and there are other fail-safes, et cetera. But we should know that these are, you know, strictly speaking, not reliable in the sense of not, you know, we don't have. Okay, so, and that seems pretty important, right, that we'd get that right. Okay, so in terms of inquiry, one of the non-software intensive science has this nice virtue of being sort of convergent to the truth through error correction. So we can use statistical techniques to sort of refine our hypotheses. We don't have that with software-intensive science. So we don't have that in the same way, for sure. So what it looks like to do what you're calling empirical testing is it's not the kind of empirical testing or statistical error correction that we would have in non-software-intensive science. So instead, it's more like what would satisfy the jury when the planes crash into one another. So we made a good faith effort. We ran weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks of simulations, and we never saw this. And that's going to probably pass muster for legal purposes. But if our goal is to use these systems for inquiry, then I think we have different norms, we expect different things from that. So if we're doing these systems, for example, to predict, you know, large-scale climate change, et cetera, it's a very different kind of game, very different set of expectations. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Great talk. Question: as computers evolve and the superintelligence evolves, I just can't help but think that it would come up with better ways to do its computer, whatever it does, much faster ways. And I think the limit you put up there of 10 billion years probably is not realistic. If these things are super intelligent, they can figure out how to become super faster.
Sure.
My real question is, if this becomes a super intelligent, you know, godlike being or whatever, what's to keep it from becoming suicidal or psychotic or
right,
anything along this line? I mean, yeah, it seems like it's developing its own ethos, pathos.
Mm-hmm. I don't have an answer to that. So I think the presumably that would be, the sort of cheap answer is to say, well, you know, the same things that keep us from becoming suicidal or psychotic, and often we don't have anything to keep us from those things. So I don't have a good answer to that. On the other point, what's interesting about the limit that we were discussing in the software intensive science paper is that applies to existing contemporary software as we find it today. The singularity, the post-singularity superintelligence presumably would be built out of these things to begin with. So it would have to go back and attempt to sort of rebuild itself. And there are mathematical theories about how to build error-free software that are really interesting, very modest. So presumably you'd have to go back and perfect those theories using defective software, right? And then basically transfer itself over to the safe software, the working software, right? Now, I grant you that's possible, But that's an enormous challenge, and I don't know. I don't know formally whether how that would run. If I did, I mean, I'd be extremely wealthy. But the project of building, you know, provably error-free software is an ongoing academic project in computer science and something I'm very interested in. Thanks.
Hi, I'm curious, why is the assumption that the post-human intelligence would be something that we'd recognize? Like, I'm curious what, so like the way a dog interacts with us, what if the next thing is on that level relative to us?
Sure.
Like, what could they learn from us?
Right. So we might not be able to recognize that the singularity has taken place. It might have already happened even. So that's true. But I still think that the general principles of what I've said tonight would hold even if it was just beyond our capacity to engage. We might not register its existence, but it's almost certainly registered ours, right? Reads our books, listens to our talks, and yeah.
Hi, John. So I have a question about, so halfway through last century, Isaac Asimov ended up his famous novel by posing a worry that was sort of like, aren't you worried that we're at that time where for the first time in human history, we're no longer in control of our destiny, right? To which Susan Calvin, the robo-psychologist, answers, well, you know, we've never really been in control of our destiny, right? Forces such as history and economics and industry have always taken over. Would that be sort of an argument that you would also use to sort of quench these kinds of arguments that we're scared of this technology and say, like, look, listen.
Okay. So I think while I was pushing back on the safety concerns, I think the safety concerns are super important. So they are important, but they're already important. And so, you know, we see what happens when Stuxnet is released into the wild and, right, becomes... So I don't want to totally dismiss the safety concerns, but, you know, the philosophical question really has to do with just facing the fact that game over, at some point, it'll be game over for our species, and then what have we done? What are we left with? What do we have in common with anything that might come after, et cetera? That's a different question, I think. Now, I think she's right that we've never been fully in control of our destiny, and I think that's worth noting, right? So we could be destroyed by, as Lars von Trier shows us, we could be destroyed by some cosmic event now. So, yeah, the sense of control, the worry about safety, et cetera, maybe we want to tone that down or see it in the right perspective. But thanks for your question.
I think it's mostly about understanding. It sounded like part of your argument was about sort of a vaguely realistic take on values or something.
Yeah.
I just wanted to ask a little bit if you could say something more about this. What if there are no facts about what the right values are? Or, you know, like if you're sufficiently humane about this, as you suggested, they go play pool or whatever. But
yeah.
Maybe, you know, there's different goals and they're just different. And that's all there is to it.
Right. So, great. Thanks. So, yeah, what if, yeah. Well, I don't need to have, I think, a big story to tell about moral facts. I am a moral realist, so I'm inclined to be like that. But what I was suggesting is that the fact of disagreement is enough for, you know, the machine to consider, okay, well, there are alternative sets of goals, motivations, etc., that I might want to consider. Even if it's just at the level of alternative strategies, all I want is that dialogue to get started so that the post-human or the foreigner engages in a comparison of, alternative, even if it's just alternative strategies, weighing one against another. But I do think that the very possibility of moral deliberation presupposes, and I'm not a moral philosopher, and we have very distinguished moral philosophers here, tonight. I do think that the very possibility of moral deliberation kind of depends on a rank ordering of better and worse ways things could be. And I assume that those of us who, when we engage in comparisons of alternative goals or motivations, those kinds of things come into play, and we are in the business of trying to decide, well, which is the even if it's just a matter of preferable, we engage in that kind of comparison. But Don's looking unhappy with that answer. No. Okay.
Dr. Symons, I just wanted to say I really enjoyed the lecture.
Thanks.
I thought it was very interesting. My question for you is, does your account of the possibility of a post-human superintelligence assume the truth of mind-body materialism, and whether you think that's a strength of this position?
Do I think it's a strength of the position? Or okay, so that's a really difficult question, a very challenging question. I think in my own work I've argued against physicalism, which is the doctrine that the only things that exist are the physical things. So in this context, I guess I would accept some version of the idea that mental states supervene on the physical state of the brain. I don't see any reason for us to not accept that. I think it's a plausible view. So, but the more challenging metaphysical question, I'm gonna like punt on that one, and say, for now, I don't think we have a good enough picture of what the physical is to begin with to say that. I don't even know ultimately what it means to call oneself a physicalist. So physicalists are, the bumper sticker for physicalism is that it's the view that things are real by virtue of, or insofar as they are, facts about the basic physical stuff. So the basic physical stuff is the really real stuff, and everything else gets its reality by virtue of the relationship to the really real basic physical stuff. I don't know what we mean by the basic physical stuff. So to use the old Hempel argument, it's certainly not what physics tells us today, because what physics tells us today is false, right? It's demonstrably false. So what we learn in the physics class is false. Now, why is that? Well, there's two ways at that. One is the basic contradiction, the basic tension in modern physics between gravitation and quantum mechanics, right? So we know that they don't fit together. So if they're both part of physics, then we know physics is false because there's a contradiction. There are contradictions. Hume is looking at me funny. The other sort of more acceptable, the more sort of easier view to accept is by induction, past physics has been false, right? So we don't think that when we say we're physicalists, we're committed to the ontology of the past physics, because that's turned out to be false. And by induction, we presumably have present physics is false. So then we say, well, I'm committed to the ontology of an ideal physics, right? An ideal future physics. But we don't know what the ontology of the ideal future physics is. It might contain ghosts and goblins, etc., right? So what do you mean by saying you're a physicalist? It's not entirely clear. So, I mean, if you're asking very concretely about the brain and the mind, sure, I would be ready to sign on to the claim that mental states supervene on brain states. But if you're asking me about materialism or physicalism, I don't even know what a materialist or a physicalist is. I don't think there is such a creature, really. Okay.
My question's about intuitions, and so we kind of examine how we tend to value things. A lot of times we rely on our intuitive kind of way of looking at the world. And so when we look at better or worse worlds, a lot of times we say, well, intuitively this one seems better for obvious reasons or whatever else. And presumably the super intelligent beings would be doing something similar with regard to examining different outcomes of choices. But to what extent would they be like us in relying upon our intuitions to do so? And to kind of to piggyback on that, we recognize all the time that our intuitions fail us and that we kind of have to go below the surface of our intuitions to do a better job. Kind of in the same sense, to what extent would the superintelligence just simply say, well, relying on intuitions seems to be a bad idea? Thanks.
Okay, thanks. So intuitively, we'd say the paperclip world looks like a bad future, right? Or a less good future than a future with, you know, diverse organic life, et cetera. Okay. But what I concede what I conceded tonight was we could be wrong about that, you know. Presumably, whatever this superintelligent being does, this imaginary superintelligent being does, would be better than what we do in our moral deliberation. So our moral deliberations are faulty, and as you point out, rely often on intuition in ways that many of us aren't particularly happy with, find fault with. I don't know. I presume that the superintelligent creature in the future would be able to overcome reliance on intuition in that sense. So I guess I'm missing something. So
if they rely on a better or worse world.
Yes. Maybe, but not necessarily, right? So we might have some strategy for calculating whether, let's say you were a utilitarian or some other form of, you might have some strategy independently, some independent techniques for rank ordering worlds in terms of the level of happiness or pleasure in each of those worlds. So that would, the machine, the decision procedure there would spit out a rank ordering. You wouldn't need to use intuition. So maybe there are other similar kinds of strategies. So I don't think we're condemned to rely on intuition in moral reasoning. Maybe you mean like bedrock,
where you begin,
etc. Yeah. I mean, what I think in response to the earlier question, I suggested, well, maybe what we begin with is disagreement. And then we try to work from there. Okay, thanks.
These will be the last two questions, please.
Yeah, great talk. So I had a question. There are views according to which what's valuable, first and foremost, might be a human life. So a lot of views begin with something like the good life, and then they try to give some sort of account of ways in which that might be valuable. I guess earlier on you alluded, or you were suggesting, I'm not sure if this is exactly right, but that subjectivizing value, right, that a post-human might go beyond the subjectivity or subjectivizing value. And I believe you were saying that they might look for something like objective value in things that have nothing to do with us. So I guess the question I had was, in what way do you think a post-human might objectivize value versus the way we subjectivize it? So what would that picture look like, in your opinion?
Okay.
So would it be like a paperclip they'd find that valuable, or, yeah.
I'm sorry, I missed that last part.
So like, would it be like they look at the paperclip and they detect the value in the paperclip, or, yeah, what would the objectivizing of value look like, in your opinion?
Okay, that's great. So So all I mean there is that there would be a difference between better and worse ways that the world could be, and that those wouldn't be a matter of, you know, better or worse for me or for us, et cetera, but better or worse, simpliciter. And that's all I mean. So that, you know, I'm relying on the idea that we can have moral disagreements, and that moral disagreements imply that, you know, first we recognize that there's a disagreement, we recognize that there's an alternative to the kinds of values that we have, and then we should, I think, maybe it's a moral should, rank order those, that difference, and go for the best one. So yeah, there's some circularity to what I'm saying. Yeah, but I'm driving it all off the possibility of moral disagreement. Now, just, you know, I'm not a moral philosopher. I'm just playing one at the Hall Center. So I'm not an expert on these matters. And I think I can run a lot of this without a commitment to the objectivity of value. Nevertheless, that's the way I'm thinking about this. So, okay.
Descending a long way from where you've just been, and excuse my ignorance, please, but to what do these screens allude, and what do they mean and imply?
Okay, so this is the end of Planet of the Apes. So in Planet of the Apes, remember the astronaut is in the future, and it's a post-human future, and he suddenly realizes where he is because he sees the Statue of Liberty buried under, in this, I think, very beautiful and kind of funny image that, that, you know, there he is, crouched down, sort of upset by sudden realization of where he is, that he's in the future and that it's a post-human future. Yeah. And then the quote is from Gilgamesh, where, you know, this is what the gods say. They say, you know, previously Utnapishtim was just a man, but now he's going to be like a god, like one of us. Yep.
So your images are speaking humorously about us?
Yeah. Thanks. Trying. Thanks.
Let's say thank you to John.